winter is definitely behind us. And spring is here. It's even a bit warmer than spring, I think, because you can tell by the wind. When you pop the wind out here, you know you're going to have a reasonably warm day. Who's ready for this morning? That's about an eighth of you. That's good. You know that you need to prepare yourself when you come to church. It's not just a matter of having a shower, and well, hopefully having a shower, and getting dressed and coming in. Try and leave your cares at the door when you come in so you can come in and focus on where the focus needs to be. Yeah, amen. So we've got a guest speaker with us this morning. Gerard, I kept thinking it was Gerard, but that told me it would be a double R, but it's Gerard. Gerard Field. Where is he? Gerard's over here somewhere. Come all the way from Nowangara. And if you've never even seen that actual word, you could be trying to say Gononga Guga. No, it doesn't work. It's a silent G. Nowangara. But he didn't just come this morning. He came during the week. Came here Thursday, which was awesome to check it all out. So, let's dive into our service this morning. Why don't you come to feet as we sing King of Heaven.
Thank you.
You've got his number, have you? You said you know him. Oh, you know of him, that's what I mean, yeah. So I'm not even going to explain it. I'm just going to let the video play and Phil Wickham explain this new song that he did just about 9 months ago. Play that, Tristan.
Guys, we're here on the music video for House of the Lord. I am so thrilled about this song. It says, there's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And what I realized this last year when I wrote the song in the middle of 2020, pandemic, we weren't even allowed to meet in the literal house of God. What I realized is that the house of the Lord is not something that's made by hands, not something that's made by man. It's you and it's me who call ourselves believers in Jesus. God lives inside of you. We are the church. A building is not the church. You and me are the church. And inside of you is everything you need to totally impact and shape and change the world around you for the kingdom of God. Jesus has put inside of you and inside of me life everlasting, joy that cannot be stolen. We may experience tribulation and grief and pain. That's a part of the human experience. But deeper than that is a joy that Jesus has given, for he's given us a future and a hope. Check out the song, House of the Lord. Sing this song with me. Wherever you are, you be the house of the Lord. Bring the presence of God wherever you go. Amen.
We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house.
Shout out his praise. Amen. Go home, have a listen to it. Look it up online. It's a really catchy song with great lyrics in there, especially about, you know, being joyful. And talking of joyful, take a seat. Talking of joyful, this lady absolutely bounds out in joyfulness. We're going to have Bronwyn. And are you going to bring the other half with you at the same time?
Bounding out in
joyfulness.
Joyfulness.
Yeah, come on up, man.
That's fantastic. Thanks. I feel like I need to do some bounding. I haven't been able to do any jumping. You want to come stand up here? Come stand up here. Stand up here. So, good morning, church. It is so good to be here. It is so good to be here. I missed you all last week. I was on retreat and I had mixed emotions. Everybody's been asking me how it was and I was like, yep, it was okay. It was okay. It was hard because I love my family. And I enjoy being here with you guys on a Sunday and to have the whole weekend out to talk to the Lord. And when you're called by the Lord to talk to him about some stuff, sometimes it's a little bit scary, you know, the fear and trembling side of our relationship with the Lord sometimes comes into play a little bit. So it was cool, but it was also a little bit scary. Because when he calls you and he says, hey, I want to spend a whole weekend talking to you, you go, oh my goodness, all right, better get ready. Because he's the king, right? We're going to see the king. Oh, my goodness. Anyway, so that's where I was, and I'm so glad to be here and see you today. And it's school holidays. Yeah. Are you excited about that? Yeah, I am. Mixed emotions, right? So there's a couple of things that are going on. Now, Stephen wanted me to tell you, and I agree, that this is really fantastic. Usually he does the emails and gets all of the information out to you people via email, which is awesome. Thank you so much for that service to our church because it is so important and massively valuable. But if you don't have a computer, or you just don't like working with one, like me, hence all the paper in my hand, and you would like to receive it a printed copy, then do come and see me and I will point you to Stephen or come and see Stephen and get yourself informed. Doesn't matter whether it's paper or electronic, be involved and be in the know. So, can you hold that? That one there. Now to the business. Junior church. There's no junior church because we're all on holiday. Some people are here, some people are not here. So if you are here and you're a junior church kiddo and you would like something to do during the service, go up to the back. Ben, he's on sound, won't know what to do. But somebody will meet you there and make sure you get a little file, a little pack to look after yourself during the service so that you can be engaged and supported and looked after. So make sure you do that. Teen church. I don't know how many teens we have here today. One, two. Oh, yeah, good job, Frank. he's bounding in joyfulness too. Teens church is back. So we had a little break for a bit, but we have got a group of kids together who have been asking for it and also parents that have been saying, hey, how about we get something going. So from the 16th of October, we are going to be doing Teen Church on the 16th of October, 20th of November and 4th of December, which is really awesome. Just to pull God's kids together, these young adults that are ready to make a way and just want to hook up and get connected. So look forward to seeing you all there, teens, because I'm on the first week and then I'm going to be talking to some other people and we're going to get some more stuff organised. Now, my boy and some of the other guys, a few weeks ago, I don't know if you saw that the field out the back over there was a field, and now there's part of it that is mowed. Crazy. Thank you very much for your donation of a lawnmower to help with that. And apologies that the band got broken. Teens, they have lots of energy. They have lots of time, but they don't have a lot of money. And so they would like to create a soccer pitch out the back, but they need money because, or they need yellow sand. So if you can donate yellow sand or money, or your car needs a wash, They are getting together on the 16th of October after church here, and they are hoping to wash, I don't know, as many cars as will exhaust them. And I'm looking forward to seeing my child lie down on the couch and say to me on Sunday evening, I never want to wash another car again. And I'll say to him, good, I'll see you in a month. So, 16th of October, lock it in for your car to get washed. Invite your friends to come to church if you like. If they're not so keen on church, that's okay. Invite them to come along and have their car washed and we can serve them in that way. $10 would be great if you have some coin to hand over to these guys to get your car washed so that they can start making some money to get together their little soccer pitch and a great little place for the youth to play out the back of their homestead, which would be fun. Men's brekkie is on as usual. Bible study is on as usual. I'm going fast now because I talk too much. Office is closed because Grace is working from home. Lucky you. That's cool. So if you need any information or you need to make, you know, get connected, talk to Grace or talk to, there's the email, the text and all that sort of stuff on the flyer. Save the date, junior church picnic. Now, it's really not actually just for the junior church kids. It's for older people and for younger people and for the house of the Lord. So if you are old, come along. If you are young, come along. If you are middle-aged, don't you love that word, come along because it's going to be a really good time and the weather is going to be amazing. We are praying that it's not going to be boiling hot. It should be really fun and we are planning some really great intergenerational activities. Let's call it that. Now you're interested. You ready to pray?
There's a number of things that have been listed in the church newsletter that we talked about that you can pray about during the week. And I might just lead us in some of those things. So let's close our eyes and bring it to the Lord. So, Father, we thank you for this place. We thank you for this church and all the exciting things that are happening in the life of our community and the life around us. Lord, we thank you for your provision. We thank you for your love. We thank you that it's a new day, a new week, and a new month, Lord, and that you are in the times and the seasons. And we thank you, Lord, that you have brought us here today. Lord, our world is in need. There is so much chaos that is happening around us. And Lord, we want to bring to you the world events and ask for your provision, your wisdom for world leaders, Lord, for our government, Lord, for our Prime Minister and our leaders around the world, Lord, as they look at Russia and Ukraine and the catastrophes that are happening overseas, Lord, and we ask for your hand to be upon these situations. Lord, these events are so far away from us, yet we know that you care about them. And because you care, Lord, we care. So we lift them up to you. Lord, our missionaries too, who are overseas, for David and Jenny Jupiter, and Lord, for Mike and Kerry, we thank you for them. Lord, we ask for your provision for them, that they would have the resources that they need. Lord, we ask for good relationships as they build connections with the communities that they live in. Lord, that they would have opportunity to build strong friendships that would enable them to share your love and your joy and your word with the people around them. Father, we lift up those who are unwell as well. We thank you for those of us who have good health, but we lift up those who are not well, and we pray, Lord, that they would reach deep into your love and your joy. Father, that they would find strength and comfort in your word. Lord, that they would live each day knowing your blessings and knowing that you are with us. And Father, we just continue to trust you. Trust in the Lord and do good, to dwell in the land that you have given us. Father, that we would build our relationship with you because we need you and our world needs you. And Lord, as we continue our service, we pray that we would learn more about you, more about how we can rely on you and trust in you, and how we can bring that love to other people around us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Church. what the Lord has done in me. Lord, praise your name for what you've done in me. Lord, praise your name for what you've done in us. Father, may we leave this morning differently than the way we walked in. Amen. Psalm 37, I think it's about verse 7, which we'll get later. It has two words, very, very important words. Be still. You know, in my leading and several times that I've been up here, I talk about being still. Be still.
Be still right now in the house of the Lord. The Holy Spirit come through and change you. You're in control. We thank you and praise your name on the absolute highest of highs, because you are the King of the Kings. You are Princes of Princes. You are Lord of Lords. You are the rock on which we stand. And the church said, Amen. Take a seat. The Bible reading is going to come up as Jared prepares himself to come up. I forgot about communion. I'm getting ahead of myself. I'll get the team, Ange, and the team are going to come back, actually, sorry. Yeah, I forgot about that. Craig, why don't you come up and give us communion?
Well, this one actually sounds appropriate. Every few weeks we do communion. It takes about 10 minutes. We get a small bit of cracker, a small drink, and mostly we read from 1 Corinthians 11. So why do we do it? It can get a bit, yeah, we did it last time, we're doing it again. So as I get the opportunity to prepare for this, I get a bit more time to actually think about what we're doing. And I'm really grateful for that. I read the Gospels accounts and I read 1 Corinthians 11 and it says, remember. I also read in Luke 22, verse 15, about what Jesus said about the first communion. I have an eager desire to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. It was important to Jesus to do this, so it's important for me. It can become just what we do every few weeks. But it needs to be much more than that because we need to remember. As we read Corinthians, it says, remember. But what are we remembering? Paul quotes Jesus, remember me, both with the cup and the bread. Two things to remember Jesus, two reasons. The first is that Jesus came as a baby and lived a perfect life, a life without sin. He followed the law. Matthew 5:17. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them. I have come to fulfill them. In this, Jesus said that he had come to live as the law required, and also to fulfill what the prophets had foretold. Much of the Old Testament points to Jesus. The second point is that in the law there is a penalty for breaking the law. The Lord commanded the man, you are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat from it, you will certainly die. Disobedience to God leads to death. We have all sinned. We've all disobeyed God. Jesus has come to die for us. We deserve to die, but he died for us. As we take the bread, remember, this is my body. We're given a perfect life in Jesus. This is what God sees. We can come before a perfect God, not because of what I have done, but because of what Jesus has done. As we take the cup, remember, this is the cup in the new covenant in my blood. The punishment I deserved is placed on Jesus. He died on the cross for me. As you take the bread and the cup, remember what Jesus has done for you. Could we have the helpers come up, please? As the helpers give out the bread and the cup, if you could just hold them and we'll eat and drink together. For I receive from the Lord what I pass on to you. The Lord, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Lord, as we take this bread and this cup, help us to remember you. As that becomes part of us, help us also to remember that you are part of us. You came to this world to die for my sins. I deserve to die. I deserve to be completely separated from you. But you came. While I was still a sinner, you died for me. You gave me this life. You took the punishment that I deserve, and you gave me the opportunity to have communion with you. We thank you for this. Amen.
Do not fret because of evil men, or be envious of those who do wrong. For like the grass, they will soon wither. Like green plants, they will soon die away. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him, and he will do this. He will make your righteousness shine like the dawn, the justice of your cause like the noonday sun. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret when men succeed in their ways, when they carry out their wicked schemes.
Okay, I'm on. Good morning. Great to see you. Thanks for having me here today. Yes, I have come from Nowangerup via Albany and via Marmion. And in fact, I came here on Thursday, and driving from Marmion was like driving from Nowangerup along Tonkin Highway and with all the traffic and everything else. So, but it's great to be here. I was just thinking, Nowangerup is Noongar for place of the mallee fowl. And I was there for 6 years, and I just realised I've never seen a mallee fowl in Nowangerup. There is a mallee fowl centre in Ongerup, and I never went there, so I've never seen a mallee fowl. And Ongerup means place of the kangaroo, Yonga, kangaroo. And I didn't see a kangaroo in Ongerup. Anyway, so great place. Hands up, have you been to Nowangerup before? One or two. Okay. Nice little town. All right, we're looking at Psalm 37. Please, if you have an app or a Bible, you can open that to Psalm 37. We'll be looking through that. Let me pray and then we'll get into it. Lord, we just pray that you be with us this morning. We thank you for the Psalms. We thank you for your word. We pray you might speak to us through it and through me. And we have hearts that are rejoicing and thankful and changed to be more like your son, we pray. Amen. Well, during the Christmas holidays last year, I was invited to go to Rottnest with my brother on his little boat, his centre console. And we went over there for the day, hooked onto his friend's boat and had lunch there. And if you've ever been to Rottnest Island over the Christmas New Year period, you know it's like Millionaire Row. Some of the boats over there are beautiful, actually, and awesome and big, and they look very expensive. And I was thinking, I was not sure if I could afford the petrol to go in the boat to get over to Rottnest in some of these vessels. So I definitely had moments of envy on that trip. I thought to myself, wouldn't it be nice just to have a boat like that? Or wouldn't it be nice to have the money to afford a boat like that? Or a job that pays as much as that pays that that person has to afford the boat that they have? Or wouldn't it be nice to gain an inheritance so big that you could just afford a boat on the side similar to that and afford to run it as well? Have you ever been envious of someone else? Maybe not their boat, maybe their house, maybe their job, maybe their income or something else. Maybe their looks or their personality or their husband or their wife. You can be envious of anything, can't you? Envy is just wanting something that someone else has. And one of the problems of envy is that it doesn't actually make you happy anyway, does it? In fact, it has the opposite effect. It leads to feelings of discontentment. You feel ripped off that someone else has something that you want. Like you've been duped, like nothing good ever happens to you. And it also leads to fear and anxiety and fretting, the psalm says, because you start to worry if you'll ever have what they have. Maybe you'll never be able to afford it. Maybe you'll always be poor and struggle and never have enough. And you start to worry about the future. Where will the money come from? How can I give my kids the stuff that other parents can afford? So envy can lead to fear and anxiety that's paralyzing. And even more than that, it leads to anger and wrath. You resent other people because they have what you don't. And you become angry at them. Why do they have it and not me? It's not fair. Why do they have a bigger boat or a better house or a better job? Why can't I have those things? And you might even start treating other people badly because of your envy, because you're not content. And you become angry at them for who they are, what they have, and you treat them differently and you sideline them and you ignore them or you exclude them. The Bible tells us that Christians are to not envy. We're not to look at others and be jealous of them and jealous of what they own or who they are. Rather, we're to look at God, the psalmist says. We're to trust in God and we're to delight ourselves in him. We're not to be jealous of others and look to them. Don't look to people's things and other people's treasures. Don't be of their things, what they have, their skills, their relationships. God is our treasure. We're to look to him. We're to delight ourselves in him, in who he is and what he has done for us. Have a look at verse 3 of Psalm 37. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Delight yourself in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. When you look to God and you trust in him and you delight in him and you commit your ways to him, then he gives you contentment. He gives you peace and gladness. He gives you the desires of your heart. Your heart will be content in knowing God and being filled with delight in him. We don't look at other people's treasures and become jealous of them. God is our treasure. He's the one who gives delight. He's the one who makes glad your heart. When we look to God, we remember the amazing God that he is, actually. How awesome he is and how loving he is. His love is boundless. His generosity is endless. His grace is amazing. God himself is just so good. Delight yourself in him. And he's so awesome, like he created everything. The fish in the sea, the birds in the air, he creates each day. He created yesterday. Yesterday was a beautiful day. I went for a ride on my friend's bike down in Hillary's Marina along the beach. It was amazing. God made all that day. And when we delight in God, we remember all the things also that he's done for us. Think about some of the things that God has already done for you. Think about his salvation. He saved you from death and gave you eternal life. That's worth delighting in. And his forgiveness, think about the sins of yours that have been forgiven, all of them. Even the sins that you think might not be forgiven because they're so evil, even them, he's forgiven. That's a great joy. Think about his presence in your life. Think about answered prayer. When you had an anxiety and you brought it to God and he answered your prayer. And he gave you peace. Knowing the peace of God is such a precious gift. I have a friend in Nawangarup in his 80s. He lives in town on his own. His wife has passed away. And he has 6 kids and he's got about 12 grandkids. All his kids and grandkids live elsewhere. And he loves living in Nawangarup. He loves his house. He calls his house his palace. I've been there. It's definitely not a palace, but he calls it his palace. And I asked him, what is it that you love about Nawangarup so much? And he said, oh, I love the peace. I just love the peace. He said, don't get me wrong, I love my kids and my grandkids, but oh, I love the peace, the peace. God gives peace. And if you've ever had answer to prayer where he gives your heart peace, you'll know what I'm talking about. It's the peace that comes from God, which surpasses understanding. It's an awesome gift, a peaceful, settled heart. God himself is our treasure, and all the things he's done for us all, it's a treasure. And if you delight yourself in him, he will give you the desires of your heart, the real desires, love and peace and joy and contentment. Then you actually won't care what other people have because you're so settled and delighting in him. So don't get envious towards other people. Don't get caught up in what other people have, what they earn, how they act. It just leads to fear and anger, which is evil. Now, one of the problems we have, of course, is that we live in Perth. And there's a lot of money in Perth, it seems. People have good jobs with good incomes that can afford the new boat and the bigger house and the nicer clothes and the third property down south. And we see it every day, don't we? It's in our face as we walk down the street. It's on TV. It's on Instagram. There's worldly treasure on show all the time. Every ad is telling us that we need it. And there's real risk of envy because it's in our face. There's a lot of money around. And of course, also, none of that stuff's evil in itself, isn't it? Money's not evil. Things are not evil. The problem is when it leads to envy and jealousy, or when it becomes an idol, when they replace God in our life. That's the issue, not the things themselves. And so Jesus says in Matthew 6:24, no one can serve two masters. You cannot serve both God and money. And where your treasure is, there your heart will be. You know, if your treasure's in God, your heart will be with him, won't it? You'll love God. You'll delight yourself in him. He'll give you the desires of your heart. But if your treasure's money, that's where your heart will be. You'll worship money or success or status. And then you'll envy other people who have more than you because they have more than you. You become resentful and angry and you'll never have enough. So don't envy others. Rather, delight yourself in the Lord. So we're looking at Psalm 37, aren't we? Well, I spoke to Don, he said, we're looking at the Psalms. So choose a Psalm. So I choose Psalm 37. And then I read it and realized it's a lot bigger than I thought. It's 40 verses long and there's a whole lot in it. So I tried to simplify it to get my head around it. So what is Psalm 37 about? Well, largely, it's about wickedness, the wicked, and the righteous. The psalmist compares the wicked against the righteous and what they do and what they're like and how God will treat each. So let's have a look through at the wicked and the righteous from the psalm and see what each is like. So what is each like? Firstly, this. The wicked die, but the righteous endure forever. The wicked have no future. They're cut off. They all perish. They all die. But the righteous have a future full of life. They will inherit the land. They will dwell in it forever. So just let's skim through Psalm 37. I'll go through a few verses if you've got it open. Is there something I need to do with this? No. And let's see what it says about the wicked. So verse 2, for like the grass, the wicked will soon wither. Like green plants, they will soon die away. Verse 9, for evil men will be cut off. Verse 10, a little while and the wicked will be no more. Though you look for them, they will not be found. Verse 12 and 13, the wicked plot against the righteous and gnash their teeth at them. But the Lord laughs at the wicked, for he knows their day is coming. Verse 14, the wicked draw the sword and bend the bow to bring down the poor and needy, to slay those whose ways are upright. But their swords will pierce their own hearts. Their bows will be broken. Verse 20, but the wicked will perish. The Lord's enemies will be like the beauty of the fields. They will vanish like smoke. Verse 34, shall I turn it off? Verse 34, wait for the Lord and keep his ways. He will exalt you to inherit the land. When the wicked are cut off, you will see it. Verse 35. I have seen a wicked and ruthless man flourishing like a green tree in its native soil, but soon he passed away and was no more. Though I looked for him, he could not be found. So the wicked die, they perish, they're cut off from life, they'll be cut off from God. The psalmist says he even sees it himself. Verse 35, he says he's seen a wicked guy and a ruthless man flourishing. I'm going to turn it off. Keep going. There's always issues, isn't there? Technology. You get used to it. Yeah. Luckily, right at the moment, my computer's still scrolling. Wait until that breaks down. So the psalmist himself looks around and he knows a wicked and a ruthless guy, and he's seen him and he looks so strong and so rich and so healthy. But he soon went and passed away and was no more. And he even looked around for him. Where's that guy that I've seen that's so... Well, he's gone. He was so successful. Surely he's still there, but he's not here anymore. He's dead. The wicked all perish like the grass. And maybe you've seen it yourself. Maybe you knew someone personally or someone in the media. Someone who... I'll turn it off and we'll see how... One, two. Yep. Okay. So maybe you know someone personally. Maybe you've seen someone in the media, someone who was rich and strong and healthy. They looked invincible. They looked like they'd live on forever. But then they died. It happens. And you might have even looked for them yourself, but now they're gone. Even the rich and the powerful die. Even the fit and the healthy, they get sick and die. And so the Lord says, don't be anxious when wicked people succeed. Don't worry when they scheme. They're not actually around for that long. God's not worried about wicked people. In fact, he says in verse 13, the Lord laughs at the wicked because he knows their day is coming. It doesn't matter how strong they are. It doesn't matter how healthy they are or how popular. Their day is coming. Soon they'll be gone and you won't see them anymore. They'll die and face God's judgment. The wicked all perish. How does that compare to the righteous? Well, the psalmist says over and over again that the righteous will inherit the land. They will dwell in the land forever. Have a look again with me. Verse 9. Those who hope in the Lord will inherit the land. Verse 11. But the meek will inherit the land and enjoy great peace. Verse 18. The days of the blameless are known to the Lord, and their inheritance will endure forever. Verse 22. The wicked borrow and do not repay, but the righteous give generously. Those the Lord blesses will inherit the land. Verse 27. Turn from evil and do good, then you will dwell in the land forever. For the Lord loves the just and will not forsake his faithful ones. They will be protected forever. Verse 29, the righteous will inherit the land and dwell in it forever. And verse 34, wait for the Lord and keep his way. He will exalt you to inherit the land. When the wicked are cut off, you will see it. So the righteous will inherit the land. What does that mean? It's just talking about eternal life and heaven and the new creation. All Christians have eternal life and we will all dwell with God in the new creation forever. Jesus gives eternal life to anyone who believes in him. He says in John chapter 5 and verse 24, I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. So Christians already have eternal life. If you believe in Jesus, you already have eternal life. You've already crossed over from death to life. Yes, you'll die physically, but you have eternity with God and he will raise you from the grave to be with him. And you'll be with him in the new creation, the new heaven and the new earth. Basically, that means you'll inherit everything. That means you'll inherit everything. That's what Paul says in Romans chapter 8 and verse 32. Let me read it for you. He who did not spare his own son but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? God is going to give you everything. I mean, why not? He's already giving his one and only son to die for you on the cross. Of course he's going to give you everything. We're all going to share everything in the new creation forever. Where there's life and love and an abundance of relationship, you will dwell there with God forever. You know, when you just have family over or good friends over and you just hang out. You know, hanging out? Yeah. There's no particular agenda. You just invite friends over and you hang out. You might eat a bit, might have a coffee, you might play some cards, go for a walk, whatever. It's just really good time of friendship and relationship. It's really satisfying and loving. There'll be plenty of that in eternity, just dwelling with each other, hanging with loved ones, enjoying relationship, being with Jesus and with God. And we'll enjoy that forever. So that's the wicked and the righteous. The wicked will perish, they'll be cut off, there'll be no more. You can look around for them, but you won't find them because they won't be there. They all perish, says the psalmist. But the righteous will live on forever. We've been given eternal life and will dwell in eternity with God. Okay, what else about the wicked and the righteous? Well, to put it plainly, the wicked are mean and nasty. They plot and they scheme, they gnash their teeth, they lie in wait for the righteous, they kill the poor and needy, they want power and wealth. That's what the psalm says. Have a look again with me, verse 12. The wicked plot against the righteous and gnash their teeth at them. Verse 14, the wicked draw the sword and bend the bow to bring down the poor and needy, to slay those whose ways are upright. Verse 21, the wicked borrow and they do not repay. Verse 32, the wicked lie in wait for the righteous, seeking their very lives. The wicked are mean and nasty. They're selfish and self-interested. All that matters to them is number one. They want wealth and power and they kill to get it. And people don't matter to them. People are just a tool to use to get what they want. And it says they even scheme and plan. They think about it. The best way to possibly use these people for my benefit. They want to use your life and your energy for what they want. And it says they hate righteous people. They hate Christians. They plot against Christians and they gnash their teeth at them. They hate Christians because Christians will call them out for what they truly are. They're wicked. It's wicked to use people. It is evil to bring down the poor and the needy. It is evil to borrow money and not pay it back when you say you will. It is wicked to use other people for your own personal gain. There's no sugarcoating it. There's no justification for it. It's just evil. Jesus came to serve, not to be served, didn't he? He came to love people, not to use people for his own gain, to build his world and his palace here. Using people is a wicked thing to do. And they hate it when righteous people call them out. They hate when their wickedness is called exactly that. How about the righteous again? Well, the psalmist says, the righteous trust in the Lord and they do good. Whatever they do, they commit to God. They ask for his guidance. They seek his permission. They look to God for answers. They pray to God for favor. And when they do that, verse 6 says, their righteousness shines like the dawn. Their justice shines like the sun. It's really shiny, isn't it? You will shine like the sun. You will stand out around other people. They'll see your goodness and your godliness. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. You won't be able to hide it, even if you tried. Let's have a look again, verse 11. But the meek will inherit the land and enjoy great peace. So the righteous will enjoy great peace. Verse 16, better the little that the righteous have. So they'll enjoy contentment. You don't need a lot to be content. Better little with contentment. Paul says he's learnt to be content either with plenty or with little, he says. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 12, he says this. I've learnt the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. Sometimes he had plenty. Sometimes he had not a lot, but he was okay. It's not the amount of stuff you have that makes you content. It's your relationship with God. Verse 19. In times of disaster, they will not wither. In days of famine, they will enjoy plenty. So the righteous will be provided for, even in times of disaster. Aren't they amazing words? In times of famine, they will enjoy plenty. It's not like you'll just get by. You just scrape by and struggle from day to day. No, you'll have ample because God says that he'll take care of you. God knows how to provide. He's kind of been doing it for a long time. He knows how to do it. And even in times of famine, he knows how to bless his people. I was reading in The Australian yesterday. There was an article with the title, Fruit, Veg, Fuel, Top Price Pain for Households. So fruit and vegetables and fuel are the top things for the pain for households because of the price. In other words, the price of fruit and vegetables is going up, causing pain for people, which is true. It is going up because of COVID and supply chains and petrol prices and all the rest of it. But I came here on Thursday and they gave out 230 boxes of food. And I'm sure there was a full pallet of oranges when we left. There's just so much food. God always provides for his people. Verse 25. I was young and now I'm old, yet I've never seen the righteous forsaken or their children begging bread. God always provides. There's no need for your children to beg for bread. I met a lady at church once, literally once, I've never met her again, who told me a story that God provided for her. She's a pensioner and she had a bill for $175, she told me, and she didn't know how she was going to pay it. And a friend of hers invited her to a women's event and the cost of entry was $5, which the friend paid for her to get in. And at the end of the day, the organizer said, at every event, we get the takings and we give it to someone in need. And she said, and they gave it to me. And she said, the total came to $175. That's what she said to me. And she was amazed. That's the only conversation I have. I haven't seen her since. She was just amazed at how God provided for her. God always provides for his people. Even in times of famine, they'll enjoy plenty. You won't need to beg for bread. In fact, the opposite's true. Look at verse 26. They're always generous and lend freely. Their children will be blessed. Christians are always generous and lend freely because they know God will provide for them. He always has. He always will. He promises to. So Christians are generous. Part of generosity, of course, is trusting God, isn't it? You're giving away now, trusting that he will provide for you in the future. If you don't trust God will provide, well, you might just hang on to things a little bit more. So part of generosity is trusting God. Christians are always generous and lend freely because they trust that God will provide for them in the future. Sometimes we're not sure how he'll provide, but just that he will, and he does. That's why Jesus tells his disciples not to worry in the Sermon on the Mount. I was going to turn to that. It's 10:46. How's our time? Keep going. Okay, right, let's turn to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6. The reason that Jesus tells his disciples not to worry about food and clothes in this section is because God knows what you need, and he's your Father, and he'll provide for you. In fact, he knows what you need before you even ask him. So let's read through it from verse 25. I'm getting glasses. They haven't arrived yet. I'm not joking. Like 3 weeks ago, I went to Specsavers and they said they'd be delivered. And that. So let's see how we go. Therefore, I tell you, Matthew chapter 6 from verse 25. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that's how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. We can seek God's kingdom first. We can trust the Lord and do good because he says he'll provide for us. He's our heavenly Father. He knows how to provide for you and for me. So don't envy the wicked. Don't look at other people and worry that you'll always be without. It just leads to resentment and anger. Delight yourself in the Lord, trust in him, and he will give your heart satisfaction and the desires of your heart. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the psalmist who put these words down on paper for us. It says a lot of heavy things about the wicked and about life. So we pray that even they will come and turn to you. But we thank you for your blessings to the righteous, all the things that you've done for us already, and even the person that you are. We pray you'd help us to delight ourselves in you. In his name we pray. Amen.
Thanks very much. Jared, are you heading back to No Anger Up today?
No.
No.
Yes.
Back to No Anger Up via Marmion?
Yeah. Albany.
What an excellent word. Please stick around for some tea and coffee and some fellowship afterwards. Yes, or is everyone just racing home? I'm going to my mum and dad's for a roast. Woo! You're welcome anytime, Johnny. Why don't you come to your feet? The Lord blesses us Every day, yes? The Lord watches over us every day, yes? We look to the Lord every day? Do you know where we're going with this? Yeah, cool. All right. Here we go. What to say, Lord, it's you gave me life and I can't explain just how much you mean to me now. But you saved me, Lord, I give all that I am to you. And every day I can be a light that shines your name. Every day, Lord, I learn to stand upon your word. And I pray that I might come to know you more. But you will guide me in every single step I take there. Every day I can be a light unto the world. Every day it's you I live for. Every day I follow after you. Every day I walk with you, my Lord. Then I stand upon your word and I pray that I might come to know you more. That you will guide me in every single step I take. That every day I can be a light unto the world. Every day it's you I live for. Every day I follow after you. Every day I walk with you, my Lord. Sing that again. Every day, it's you I live for. Every day, I follow after you. Every day, I won't be you, my Lord. It's you I live for every day. 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 Every day, it's you I live for. Every day, I follow after you. Every day, I walk with you, my Lord. Every day, it's you I live for. Every day, I follow after you. Every day, I walk with you, my Lord. It's you I live for every day. Give the Lord a hand. Please stick around for some tea and coffee. Thanks very much for joining us. Have a great and blessed week.